Dear students, I am Professor Vibhuti Patel, head of the Department of Economics of S&T Women's University, Mumbai. Topic of today's discussion is on gender budget and empowerment of women. This is part of paper number 4, Women in Economics, and module number 9. Budget creates a lot of excitement among different sections of the economy. We all know that how the kind of heated debates we have on television, on radio, in the public fora around the month of February, March, and every stake group, whether you are industrialist or chartered accountant or legal expert or lay citizen, all of us are very, very clear that budget impacts our life greatly. What is gender budgeting? It's not a separate budget for women, but it is a budget that sees how men and women are impacted differentially due to financial allocation that we are making. Another very important concern that gender budgeting has, that whatever gender commitments of equality, development, empowerment, enabling environment, positive ecosystem that you want to create for women should be translated into financial commitment, because in a market economy, without fund allocation, nothing can be achieved. Main objectives of gender budgeting is to see the gender sensitivity in schemes, programs, and variety of activities and the action plan that you have. To improve the analysis of incidence of budgets, because whatever budgetary allocation you have made, it should not like pouring water in sand, which where you just don't get any result. Third one is to attain more effective targeting of your financial allocation, that whatever you want to achieve, that should be kept in mind while giving the financial allocation, and also to offset any undesirable impact of budgetary allocation that can create negative implication for women. So, these four main objectives, they determine what kind of gender budgeting that any country wants to pursue. It's a very interesting history to go into how the gender sensitivity about the budget came. It was in 1984 that young women from Australia, they demanded from their government that it was very difficult for these women who at the age of 15, their parents tell you to manage your life yourself. And this because in most of the industrialized countries, children are expected to be independent at the age of 15. And these women were finding, young women were finding very, very difficult immediately after your high school, when you have to fend for yourself, you have to find your house and you have to have your employment and you have to take help of unknown people who take advantage of your helplessness. The women from these young women, students and youth from Australia, they demanded from the government that what kind of gender budgeting government had done so that young women could get more enabling environment. And Australian government agreed. They started giving gender budgeting in 1984, where this government clearly mentioned that this particular was the action plan, schemes, the financial backing for empowerment of young women. After that, we saw in South Africa, when the apartheid regime was toppled and Dr. Nelson Mandela came to power, women from South Africa, they asked leaders, African National Congress leaders, that white racist regime was not bothered about African women. But you are our brothers, we have struggled shoulder to shoulder to get independence and get rid of racist regime. As our brothers, what have you done for African women's education, their health, their skill development, their employment, their better quality of life? And they also demanded that gender budgeting should be done. Now, this way, the agents for gender budgeting were different. In some areas, they were directly the ruling party. In other areas, they were the women's groups. In some other countries, it was like in war-torn countries like Bosnia, Somalia. They had to train the military officers to do the gender budgeting, because development agenda every country has. So, currently, if we see, there are 84 countries in the world who are doing gender budgeting, and they make the state plays very proactive role in gender budgeting endeavor. Commonwealth initiatives also took place to integrate the gender and national budgetary processes in South African countries, in Fiji Islands, in Sri Lanka. Then many other countries also, like North America, UK, Canada, Mozambique, Namibia, Tanzania, Uganda, there also the state took initiative in gender budgeting. And gender budgeting initiatives are adopted in a diverse socio-political cultural circumstances. For example, in Afghanistan, it was the UN body which took, UN women took initiative in gender budgeting. So now, coming to our country, the genesis of gender budgeting, I think you can see in Towards Equality report, which was discussed in the parliament in 1975. For the first time, like the government appointed committee said that whatever we want to achieve about women's equality, and if we want the dream of Indian constitution realized, then we need to make a very substantive financial allocation for women's empowerment and women's development. So it was to, in 1974, Towards Equality report set the ball rolling. The 6th 5-year plan gave a separate chapter called women and development in the planning process, and separate allocation for women's education, health and employment were made. Shram Shakti report, which was chaired by Dr. Ila Bhatt of self-employed women's organization, this was a very important contribution, because 94% of Indian women are in the unorganized sector, and the Shram Shakti report gave the profile of women in self-employed women and unorganized sector women, and gave a direct very concrete suggestion to the state that what could be done for empowerment of these women through budgetary allocations. National Perspective Plan for Women in 1988, which was a perspective plan for the period of 1988 to 2000, also talked of budgetary allocation. And I would like to quote 8th 5-year plan, which said that, and I quote, the benefits of development from different sectors should not bypass women, and special programs for women should be complement the general development program. That means range of anti-poverty programs we have, whether it is a MG Narega or TRISAM or Integrated Rural Development Program or JNNURM, in all these programs there should be gender sensitivity. And now even the 9th 5-year plan went one step ahead and said that 30% women's component should be there. That means in any development oriented budget, the way you have scheduled caste plan, you have a tribal sub plan, you have a budgetary allocation for minorities, the same way you should have a women's component plan. And 10th 5-year plan said that women component plan and gender budgeting should converge, and we should provide the very proper roadmap of implementing this process. In 2005, Government of India, Finance Ministry sent a GR to all state governments and Panchayati Raj institutions to submit quarterly report of gender budgeting within that particular ministry. So no ministry, no department can say we have nothing to do with gender budgeting. Ministry of Steel also can't say that, because they have a mine workers who are working in the mine, and later on the steel gets produced. Ministry of Law and Order can't say we have nothing to do with gender budgeting, because so many incidences of violence against women are increasing. So every sector of the economy has to respond when it comes to gender budgeting. Now, why do we need this exercise? Is it an exercise of one more column in your table, that for whatever you have allocated for all, so now you have three columns, all men and women? Is it a number game? No, it is not. Gender budget analysis can help to focus on neglected areas such as education, health, employment, and most important, safety of women. Gender responsive budget provides women with a vital information regarding contents and focus of existing government policies, which are the policies that to be that we should withdraw. If some state government says that we will not distribute sugar through public distribution system, so on ration card you would not get sugar, but if that sugar is diverted for production of beer, obviously we have to oppose it, because if your state has too much of alcohol, men drink alcohol, they beat up their women and children, overall nutritional status of the family goes down, then it has a negative impact. Armed with this kind of a micro analysis, women can confront the policy makers and demand changes in the policies as per their needs and choices. the process is also for greater transparency and also deepening of democracy. Because in democracy, you say talk about the formal equality, but if you want a substantive equality, then you need to provide the material basis or a financial support to reduce the gender gap. Now, there are five extremely important and critical areas in the economy, such as economic participation. We all know there is a big gap between gender gap between men and women's economic participation. Women's economic participation is 23%, for men it is comes to 57 to 65%. So we need to reduce the gap. Economic opportunities, the kind of opportunities men in male labor force has in the economy, women don't have. Why don't they have? Because there is not enough investment you have made on girls and women in terms of education, skill, opportunities, exposure, confidence building. So we need to budgetary allocation for that, more schools, more training programs, more workshops, more community based development schemes. Third area is a political participation. We have only 11% of women in the parliament, okay, which is this thing. In the Panchayati Raj Act, we have now around 16 states are giving 50% representation to women in the Panchayati Raj bodies, in the urban and local self-government bodies. Scenario is changing fast, but when it comes to legislature and parliament, still political participation is less. If you go to the educational background of women elected representative, you require, like if you want to contest election in Rajasthan, you need to pass 12th standard. How many women are getting that opportunity to go to school? Most of them drop out after 5th standard. So if we want to make our school education or secondary school education strong, we need massive budgetary allocation. When it comes to educational attainment, why do we see segregation of women only in arts and commerce? Why aren't we having more women in the engineering, architect, professional courses like law or medicine? Because parents would not invest so much in their daughter's education. So the state has to take care, and we have to see to it that more and more women go into the professional areas. So even for that, we need budget. And the fifth one, extremely crucial, is a health and well-being. India has still very, very deplorable condition when it comes to maternal mortality, anemia, iron deficiency, and also child mortality, which also demands massive budgetary allocation. The main justification for gender budgeting comes from historical neglect. Women's needs, women's demands have been neglected historically over 5,000 years. When it comes to nurturance, when it comes to food intake, when it comes to healthcare, and this historical neglect and also extremely institutionalized hegemony. Institutionalized hegemonies are extremely powerful, they are omnipresent, omnipotent, and they are extremely powerful. So these hegemonies can be countered only at a macroeconomic level, and here comes the role of public economics and budgeting. And gender sensitivity and gender responsiveness and gender awareness with respect to budget can reduce this kind of neglect and gap between the formal equality and the substantive equality. That whatever constitution promises, we need to practice it. And the most marginalized sections amongst women, Dalit, tribal, disabled, minorities, and HIV positive women, they also need extra concern and care in budgeting. India adopted Women Empowerment Policy in 2001. This is a policy which has adopted life cycle approach. That means from womb to tomb, at every stage of life, the policy touches women's lives. And it also clearly says that all ministries, corporations, banks, financial institutions, all of them are advised to collate and disseminate data for the programs and benefits of gender on a gender disaggregated basis. And this data can be used for gender budgeting so that whatever allocations are made can be properly utilized. The purpose of gender budgeting exercise is basically to verify from the actual schemes and allotments included in the budgets, how far these intentions are actually being translated into concrete policies. If our efforts to scan budget on gender sensitivity really results in a positive approach to promoting gender equality, we would have won our battle. So that's very, very important. So everyone is scared, lay people or common masses are scared of budgets. Even educated people, they shy away from budgets. So our duty is also to demystify budgets, people and elected representatives in whichever level, whether they are in Gram Sabha or they are in tehsil level or they are at district level, state government or central government, all of them need to be sensitized on gender, on this kind of budgets, and then only we can fully empower women politically, educationally, economically and legally. Now, how to translate our gender commitments into budgetary commitments? For that, transparency and accountability for revenue generation. How are we going to generate revenue? Every state government says we will use our grapes for making wine, we will use our best quality wheat to make beer. All of them want to get revenues from alcohol. To what extent, women's groups are asking, to what extent generating revenues from alcohol? And so many state governments have gone ahead and said that, okay, whatever money we generate from the alcohol cess will be used for welfare of women and children. This is a totally wrong logic. First you want population to get drunk, then beat up their family, not to give whatever they earn to their family members, and then you say that the state will provide welfare for women and children. This kind of logic has been questioned by elected representatives. In Maharashtra, we have 13 all women panchayats, and these women panchayats, they say that they don't want a single license to be given for alcohol shop in their village, because this is the main reason for deteriorating nutrition, not getting enough, starvation in the so many families, and human miseries, domestic violence and all. And government of and all these women representatives also created a state level network and prevailed upon home minister of the state to declare that any village in which 50% of women, not through secret ballot but by raising of hands, if they say that they don't want alcohol shop in their village, that village will be declared as a alcohol free village. And this is happening because of the sheer pressure of grassroots women, women elected representatives in Gram Panchayat and Jilla Panchayat. Second very important concern we have about the translation of gender commitments into financial commitments is a reprioritization of public spending. That you have the, how government generates money and how it utilizes money, what should be the priority in terms of spending? Okay, your priority should be to create more casinos, more dance bar. In Maharashtra, we saw that 94,000 young girls were dancing in the bar, which the government stopped. They said no more bar dancing, because to attract more customers in, to sell alcohol, they were using these young school girls to dance on a Bollywood number. Now that they stopped, women's elected representatives forced the government to stop bar dancing in Maharashtra. There is a ban on bar dancing, and they said that whatever public spending you have, use for this more and more empowerment of girls. So create cycle scheme for girls, so that girls, if there are no buses coming in their village, they can go to school, give more uniform, textbooks, midday meal, or strengthen the quality of midday meal. So this should be the priority of the government in terms of public spending. Have more parks for elderly women, have more nana nani parks. There are, in the cities, there are small houses, people, elderly people are unwelcome during by the family members. So at least during the day, they can go to the community center. So create community centers in the locality. So this should be the priority in terms of women's development. Lift the veil of statistical invisibility of unpaid care economy. Women do so much of unpaid care work, of animal husbandry, collection of fuel, fodder, water, kitchen gardening, cooking, cleaning and caring in the house. Don't see that as a leisure time activity. It is a hardcore work. And once you have that attitude towards women, you will always see women as a part of the development agenda, and you will make the budgetary allocation. So it's very, very important. For example, that another thing is equality and efficiency dimension, that wherever there is equal opportunity, equal treatment and equal rewards to both men and women of the population, that economy always thrives. We have seen the economies which has 65% work participation of women, those economies are extremely prosperous. So even from the point of view of efficiency, it is very important to do gender budgeting. And for that, we will have to change our macroeconomic policies. What are the macroeconomic policies? Your monetary policies, your public economics policies, your investment in the social sector, infrastructure. How do you allocate the share, the cake of economic growth? That is very, very important. And India, after 2004, in our budget, we get gender budgeting is inbuilt. Gender budgeting statement part 1 talks about 100% schemes and programs and financial allocation only for women. That means budget of Ministry of Women and Child Development. Another section in the budget is part B, which is called benefits accruing to women. That means at least 30% of the benefits of that particular scheme or program is for women. That means most of the anti-poverty development oriented programs, 30% is allocated to women. That is the share, and they are called composite schemes. So our budget, this kind of data is given by the budgets. The actors in gender budgeting, they are basically elected representatives, motivated civil servants, administrators, citizens group, women's organizations, gender economists, they play very important role in budgeting. We have noticed that wherever there is a gender sensitive budgetary allocation, it immediately results into empowerment of women. Wherever we have seen the states which are allocating massive amount into girls' education, you immediately see that within 10 years, you see the literacy rate of that particular state going very high. We have seen the state of Rajasthan. Rajasthan has achieved a lot in terms of literacy and girls' education. Wherever we see budgetary cuts, we see reduced opportunities for women. That we have seen in a massive way due to privatization of education, where more and more private educational institutions which charge heavy fees, you see women's opportunities get reduced. Where the state withdraws from higher education, there we see that women's opportunities get reduced. Structural adjustment program, globalization, they have also increased unpaid work of women, and thereby we can say that globalization has been subsidized by women. It is the women who are shouldering the major burden of globalization, because whatever devaluation or price rise or unemployment or erosion of public distribution system or agrarian crisis that takes place, women are the one who bear the major brunt of that processes. Coming to the role of 5-year plans with respect to gender budgeting, like the term gender budgeting is quite recent, but what we have seen, if you go to the history of 5-year plan, the first 5-year plan had made an allocation of 4 crore rupees for creation of Central Social Welfare Board. There were 3 women who were managing refugee camps in a India-Pakistan and India-East Pakistan and India-Kashmir areas. These 3 women, when they were asked to become ministers, they declined. They were Pushpa Ben Mehta, Mrudula Sarabhai and Kamala Ben Patel. But what they demanded from the Prime Minister of India, that if you really respect our work we have done among women, then you create Central Social Welfare Board, where all these refugee women who have been abandoned by their families, they can be rehabilitated, and the state has to, but their family is not going to accept them. So it is the duty of the state to see to it that these women, some of them are pregnant, some of them have small children, they are looked after by state. So there is a story behind Central Social Welfare Board, which we all now know it's a very important body for any economically backward section, that was created in the first 5-year plan. By second 5-year plan, we had a budgetary allocation made to create 30,000 Mahila Mandals. Because one thing we must remember, that India is the first country to have adopted family planning as a state policy. Birth control is different from family planning. Birth control decisions are taken by the couple, whether to have children, how many children, at what interval. But when it comes to family planning, the state comes into picture. India adopted family planning as a state policy in 1950, and this first 5-year plan talked about male condoms, which did not click in Indian context. So second 5-year plan, the realization came that if we make Indian women aware that small family is a great family, small family is the best family, then and that can be done through Mahila Mandals, and the budgetary allocation was made to create Mahila Mandals throughout the country. The third, fourth and interim plans talked about women's education. By then the new slogan that had come was education is the best contraceptive, education, educated women produce less children, and we should also improve the survival chances of mothers and children. So child mortality rate must be reduced, because that was the time where Indian women had to produce 6.2 children to see to it that two of them reach the adulthood. The child mortality rate was so high those days. So concerted effort to reduce child mortality was a major concern of that period. So the fifth five-year plan coincided with the Towards Equality report. There was a paradigm shift. This was the time where there was a paradigm shift from women in the category of welfare to women as a part of development process. So from welfare to development. Sixth five-year plan started giving a separate chapter on women and development, with clear-cut understanding that development means health, education and employment. Seventh five-year plan talked about women in development approach. So effort of the planning commission was to integrate women into the development process. Eighth five-year plan coincided with constitutional amendment 73rd and 74th. That means women's entry into Panchayati Raj institutions. With one stroke of pen, 1 million Indian women crossed the threshold of domesticity and entered the Panchayati Raj institution, urban and local self-government body. Here the plan was focused more from development to empowerment. That was the concern. By then outlay also increased. The first five-year plan had allocated 4 crore rupees for women's cause. By eighth five-year plan, the allocation, fund allocation became 2000 crores. Ninth five-year plan coincided with the women empowerment policy 2001. And it also demanded 30% allocation of as a women's component within every developmental budget. 10th five-year plan talked about convergence between women component plan and gender budgeting. 11th and 12th five-year plan, they also gave the mandate to all state governments, all Panchayati Raj institutions, to continue the process of dissecting government budgets to establish gender differential impact. So more and more impact analysis were being done. So what we see that before 2004, what gender economists were doing was critiquing the ease budget. After the budget was presented in the parliament, they were critiquing and showing the limitations of budget. After 2004, they started taking part in pre-budget workshops, pre-budget session, and they started reviewing the public expenditure profile, they started conducting beneficiary analysis, and also started recommending changes in the operational guidelines. For example, working women's hostel or Swadhar, those women in difficult circumstances, budget for that. The conditionality was that you need to own land. Any group or a person who owns a land or a building only is eligible to apply for the funding of working women's hostel or Swadhar. Now most of the genuine women's groups and sincere people, they did not have land or building. At the same time, there were vested interest and antisocial elements. They had land and both building, and they got the funding, and the fund for Swadhar and working women's hostel was utilized for a wrong purpose. So many women were trafficked, and then the realization, Dr. Saida Hamid, who was a member of planning commission, she suggested that conditionality should go. So women's active participation in both review, conducting the incidence analysis, and also recommendations to create a new sensitive operational guidelines was sought by planning commission by creating a window to citizens. So citizens could also give their input for new guidelines. Now if we go through the budget after 2001 to 2017, we can see as and when women's groups have demanded particular new schemes or have provided the dissection of the budget, the allocations have increased. Ministry of Science and Technology was the first one to respond to women's demand. That means they created 100 scholarships in 2002 budget, and they also were ready to give the women's component, but there were not many takers because not many women were coming forward to take the grants or scholarships or this. National Nutrition Mission, when the women's groups or the educationists who said that we needed a midday meal program and it should be massively funded and it should not be tokenism, the substantial food should be given and school should be the center for food distribution, that budgetary allocation increased. The budgetary allocation for Swadhar, for daycare center for working mothers' children, self-help groups, microfinance, water budget, they have been discussed time and every year in last 15 years. Budget for farmers, widows of the farmers, then also budget for reproductive and child health, budget for workers, child workers, for the rehabilitation of child workers, informal sector workers, they have increased. And most of the flagship programs such as education or rural development or JNNURM, in that also women's component has been sought. Now what we see is that different sections of society who were earlier not vocal, for example senior citizens, now they are demanding budget audit from the senior citizens perspective. In Mumbai you have a cluster of 40 NGOs who are demanding right to pee. That means cities, every city should have enough ladies toilet throughout the city at every 2 kilometers distance. The way you have gents toilets, women's ladies toilets should also be there, because you start with the presumption that women don't leave home. That is totally wrong. Women leave home for work, they leave home for taking their children to school. There are informal sector workers who are working for 10 to 15 hours a day, and they all need this kind of a facilities. And there are Ministry of Minority Affairs, they have also created their budget, special gender budgeting for women's leadership. Now 54 departments of our country are providing gender budgeting. They have created gender budgeting cell. There are 33 demands for grants from 27 ministries and 5 union territories. So this is a very, very encouraging scenario, and more awareness about gender, that we can't attain gender equality without financial allocation and gender budgeting. That realization has come among different stake groups. So now you have a children's organization demanding child audit of budget, then you have a body which talk about the water audit of budget. Even in water, industry needs water, farmers needs water, housewives need water. So there too, like each stake group is asserting their needs. In the final analysis, I would like to say that if we don't engender our budget, women's lives will be endangered. That's why it is a very important duty as a citizen that we take interest, active interest in budgetary allocations and lobby for empowerment of women. I would like to conclude that gender budget debates have been very, very productive, and they have brought women's agenda center stage. Even we have women elected representatives are showing great interest in gender budgeting. Everywhere training programs on gender budgeting at a panchayat level, at urban local bodies, amongst state legislators have started in a big way. Several state governments have come forward in taking issue-based gender budgeting also. It has become an important exercise, but at the same time there are some unresolved issues such as widow's pension or public facilities for women, more budgetary allocation for safe transport. You have only couple of states, cities where you get safe transport, maybe Kolkata or Bombay or Madras, but most of the tier 2, tier 3 cities still doesn't have a state supported transport facility where so many women are now working. So, but the debate is on, and the macro policies need to be gender sensitive. That realization has increasingly come.